In this video, we are going to see the drawbacks of page faulting. When a page, the user process will be loaded into the main memory through a method called page faulting. That is, already we know the user process is divided into pages. Let us say this, this is a user process 1, 2, 3. This is, let us consider this as a main memory. And here we already know the page size is equal to frame size. When here we call it as a page and here we call it as a frame. Okay, here we don't call this as a page. So the one page is loaded into one frame of this main memory, and that information will be kept in the page table. So that using page table, the user process know where it has to find its next page in the main memory. So once it is the page is taken from the secondary storage, that will be loaded into the main memory, and that information will be entered into the which frame it is loaded. That information will be loaded into the page table, and through that it will track. This is what we have seen so far. Okay. So whenever a page is, say for example, if you take this in this user process, page one, the first user process, page one, page two, page three, page four, page five, page eight. Let us consider these are all the number of pages needed by the user process one. Here, if you see this in the main memory, 1, 2, page one is there, page two is there, then somewhere here, page three is there. So only three pages of this process is loaded. Same way, if you take this second process, process one, page two, and then this page three of this user process is, second user process is also loaded. Now let us consider third process, page one, page two. Yes, the first two pages of this process three is loaded. Now let us imagine the frame is over. That is, in the main memory, all the frames are allocated. There is no free frames. Now what happens? Say for example, after the first page, the user process one, page three is executed. Now it needs page four. Now, in the logical address page, page four is there, but it is only a reference. So now when this page four, it has to load it to, from the secondary storage. So in order to load that, a page fault takes place. After page three is executed, now it checks its page table and find the invalid bit that this particular page is not in the main memory. Now a page fault takes place, and then that particular page, that is this page four of which is loaded from the secondary storage, will be brought in, and it has to be loaded into the frame, and then that frame has to be updated in the page table. This is what has to be done. But see here, there is all the frames are full. Now it has to decide, the operating system, the CPU scheduler, it has to decide which page has to be removed. In that case, it may use a page replacement algorithm, which we have already see. But if it does not have enough frames, it needs to support its pages, it quickly page fault. Now it has to replace the existing frame for the incoming page. It may swap out a page that may need it again immediately. For example, in order to load this page 4, according to our algorithm, it may find that this is the least recently used. Let us imagine. Now this will be swapped out, and in that this page four will be loaded. After while execution of the page four, some reference may be to the page one. Immediately what happens? Already this has been swapped out. Now it is no more in the memory. So in the page table also the frame number is updated, frame valid invalid bit is updated to invalid because it is not present in the main memory. In that position only page four is present. Okay, let us imagine. So here, after replacement, let us say this is page four. Page four is like this. Now page four, again, when it refers some information, some statement in this refers page one, means now this page again has to be loaded into the main memory. In that case, again, some of the page, say for example, let us take this. So that will be replaced. Page two is swapped up and page one is brought in. Now again, after some time, immediately after the page one is executed, because of this, there may be continuity. Again, the page two may be asked again. So in that case, it will again a page fault takes place, and page two will be swapped in, and page three will be taken out. sometimes what happened, this is called local replacement. That is a process, the frames allocated to it only replace. So for example, this is for process one. Let us imagine. One only in those things, the new incoming will occupy. But some, this is called local replacement. So for example, if the page fault occurs for the second process, only the frames allocated for it will get replacement. It will not touch this. So for example, 2P2, after 2P2, 2P3 exit, then 2P4, it expects a fourth page, second user process. Now, sometimes it may take this page. Okay, so here what happens? This will be replaced to P4. In the case that P2, that is P3, whatever it is, that is 1P1, that's gone. 1P1 or 1P2, whatever it is, it's gone. Okay, so when it recurs, again it will start replacing. Maybe here it will find, and since 1P1 is not there, it will take the space of the third user process. So this is called global page replacement. What do you mean by global replacement? When a user process tries to tries to occupy the frames occupied by other user process. Here what happened? The first user process tries to occupy the third user process. Whereas the second here, this is allocated for first initially. What we have seen is it is allocated for the first user process. In that, the second user process try to occupy. So it will override. That particular page is swapped out and kept in the secondary storage, and this new page has been written here. So this is called global replacement. So in both cases, what happens? The pages are, the once a page is swapped out, after immediately that is recurred, and it is the some other process user, the frame is replaced with the incoming page. So most of the time the page fault takes place, because even if it is, if it was there, then there will be no problem. There will be, say for example here, if it is 1P2 and here 1P1, it was there. So after this execution 1P2, if it is not removed, so when a reference after this 1P3 takes place, again 1P4, or yes, here let me, is it 1P4 again, after 1P4, if 1P2 takes place, here it refers. So there will be no page fault because it is present in the main memory. So, but since it is referring the removed page, so what happened? That particular page has to be brought in again. So most of the time is spent on page fault, swapping in and swapping out. In that case, it has to wait for IO devices, the paging device, which concentrate on swapping of the respective page and allocating it to the frame in the main memory. Okay, so it may swap out a page that may be needed again immediately. That's what we have seen. So again, a page fault takes place, replacing the pages that it must bring back in immediately. So what happens? The page fault rate is very high. If it remains in the main memory, there will be that, at least that particular page fault might have been eliminated. But since we are removing this and replacing it with the incoming, and again when this page is needed, immediately that also will be brought in, and existing page will be removed. In that case, that page also will be again page fault, so on. So this keeps on doing, the page fault takes place. So most of the time the page fault takes place, and this we call it as thrashing. So thrashing is a process is busy swapping pages in and out. It do nothing. A CPU is underutilized, because the CPU is mainly involved with the processing. When there is an IO transfer, it the IO device will start doing. That is here what we call it as a paging device. It will give only the instruction to swap the particular page. Now the swapping device will take over, and it will start doing the swapping. So at that time, the CPU is doing nothing, because most of the, if the CPU has to be kept always busy, it has to concentrate on another process which is not doing any page fault, where it is present in the main memory, and it has to carry over that. But if almost all the pages are faulting because of it is not presenting there, and they will be in a page, they will be waiting for the device. So for example, here, because of this thrashing, what happens? Low CPU utilization, because what happens? Most of the time is spent on page fault. As I said, the every IO transfer only done. Say for example, first process is doing the, it is waiting. Say for example, it is waiting for the page 4. Then that will be in a queue for the paging device. Then after this execution, the CPU start executing, and by the time it is asking for the page here, this also execute page 4. Again a page fault takes. Again it is waiting. Now after, so what happened? The CPU turns its attention to the third process. Now it starts executing. By the time it is waiting the page 3, it is waiting for the page 3 of the third process. So now again a page fault takes place. All those things will be in a queue. So till it completes, say for example, page 4 of the first thing, as it is in a queue, one by one only it will be executing. So page 4, till it gets, the CPU has to sit idle. So that is a problem here. So in order to remove this problem, that is in order to maintain the CPU utilization high, what the CPU scheduler will do, it try to keep the degree of multi-programming more. That is, in this case, only 3 process. Since it is waiting for the I/O device, almost all the processes are waiting for the I/O device, what the CPU scheduler will do, it will try to take one more new process from the secondary storage and try to allocate in the memory those processes. Say, for example, in this case, for example, suppose till the page 4 is available, it cannot be process 1 cannot be run, means now it may allocate this process for the fourth incoming process. Now 4 processes are running now. Okay, so if it is now, what happens? In order to increase, now the degree of multiprogramming has been increased. For this, there will be another user process logical address space, which is not given here. But anyway, you just imagine another process will start loading. So this is called, it will start increase, because at least in this page, whatever the process is given, the CPU at least can concentrate on this and can start executing this process. So now the operating system thinks that it needs to increase the degree of multi, because the CPU is idle, because all the processes are waiting for the paged device. So another process, now by the degree of multiprogramming is increased by adding another process to the main memory. So a global page replacement algorithm is, that's what I have said, it replaces pages without regard to the process to which they belong. So for example, if the first page is, first process is allocated 1, 2, already we have seen here, it will not allocate, it will not remove the process that is this page, and the fourth, another incoming process will not occupy this page. That is, for example, it may occupy, say for example, page 3 is page in. Now it occupies the space occupied by the page, the second process, the page of the second process, and so on. So what happens? It will not replace its own frame. Okay, its own process frame. It will try to occupy the frames occupied by the other user process. So that is called global page replacement. The process which are page faulting must be paging device to swap in and sort. So they will be in a queue. So as they queue up for the paging device, the ready queue empties is the one which are ready. The CPU scheduler will take a process from the ready queue and start executing. In that ready queue empties, all the devices are, all the processes are waiting for the paging device in order for the data to come in from the secondary storage. And the ready queue is empty. So as the process wait for the paging, the CPU utilization also decreases because the CPU has nothing to do. So now what it will do, the CPU scheduler sees that there is nothing in the ready queue. So it starts swapping from a new process from the secondary storage. So that's what it increases, the multi-programming. The new process tries to get started by taking the frames. That's what we have seen. Already here, the frame of the one is there. In that, this will be, it will be, the new incoming process will occupy and whatever the old frame, it goes to the swap out into the secondary storage. By the time when this one which comes again, the swap out process may be asked again. So it causes more page fault and longer queue for paging device. So what happens most of the time, operating system spend most of its time only in reading and writing, that is swapping in and swapping out of the secondary storage. So this is what this picture represents this thrashing. That is here the CPU utilization and the x-axis is given in degree of multiprogramming. So some when you keep on increasing the multiprogramming, the CPU utilization is also increased because most of the time the CPU is kept busy, and that is what we want. But after some time, it suddenly decreases because of this thrashing. So the CPU is underutilized. By seeing that the degree of multiprogramming may be increased, but still it is not improving. So in that case, what we have to do, we have to remove any one of the process from the main memory and allocate that particular the frame which is occupied by that suspended process to some other working the one which are in the main memory. As the degree of multiprogramming increases, the CPU utilization increases to some point and thrashing sets in and CPU utilization falls sharply. At this point, we must decrease the degree of multiprogramming. So how you can decrease? By removing one of the process. So what is the effect of thrashing? This effect of thrashing can be limited by using a local replacement algorithm. In the previous case, what we have seen, we have seen the global replacement. Because of the global replacement, it occupies one user process occupies the frame of another user process, which leads to thrashing. So in this process, instead of capturing the frames occupied by the other users, a particular user process, when the swapping takes place and swapping in of another page comes, it has to take over the frames occupied by its own process. So for example, user one means the user one only has to, if you see this, see one process, one process, two process, three, when the process three is trying to get in, it must try to remove only these two, any of these two pages, and in that only P3 has to come. If any user process, second user process has to come, it can come only in this frame. It should not go and take the frame of the third process. This is called local replacement. So the effect of thrashing can be limited by using local replacement algorithm or priority replacement algorithm. This we have already seen in the previous one, that is priority. The high priority pages should not be replaced. So it can be, if a low priority process is there, those frames can be allocated to the high priority process. So what happens in this, the process cannot steal frame from another process, but still there is thrashing because see here, if another process has to come, then they will be waiting for the paging device. Okay, so here also paging device waits, page 4 of the second process, it waits for paging device. So still the waiting for the paging device is there. So to prevent thrashing, process must be provided with as many frames as they need. How to prevent this thrashing? So each process must be provided with the enough frames. How much frames they want, that much frames has to be allocated. So how to find the needed frames? For user process 1, how many frames are needed without any thrashing? For user process 2, how many frames are needed without leading to thrashing? So this has to be calculated. There are two ways you can calculate. One is the working set model and another one is the page fault frequency. Another one is this page fault frequency model. So now first we will say what is this working set model. Working set model is nothing but, already we have seen in our previous segmentations and all, how we are user is viewed. He is viewing his program as segments only. The functions, it is nothing but you can call it as a functions. And then so if as a process executes, it moves from locality to locality. So what do you mean by locality to locality? So a locality is a set of pages that are actively used together. After this, this page will be used. After this, this page will be used, like that. So closed vicinity. So your locality, so for example, if you take one function, the function may takes place in two pages, but that function will be the locality now. That will be executed. For loops may be there. That will be repeatedly asked. While loop may be there. It will be repeated. So when they are repeatedly asked, that is called locality. It will be, the pages will be executed in a close proximity. So a locality is a set of pages that are actively used together. After this, then immediately the next thing will be executed like that. A program is generally composed of several different localities which may overlap, like as I said, functions. If you allocate enough frames to your process to accommodate its current locality, we can avoid this thrashing. So how to find out enough frames for the current locality? So now it will page fault in its locality until all these pages are in memory. Then it will not fault again until it changes the locality. So for example, if you see this locality in a memory reference. So for example, if this is, these are the execution, during this execution, so for example, here page numbers 1820, here is given as page number. Most of the time this will be executed, then 20 and 22 like that, then 22, and 24, here if you see there is no locality of reference for this. 26, they have reference here. The memory is referred here. Okay, they have their own memory reference here. So if you see this, again there will be memory reference. So this is called locality of reference. So how do you calculate this locality of reference? So if you find out it is only says two functions to be executed, it's in 3-4 pages, then you can say that to be the locality of reference. Say for example, here, how you can find a working set model. Say for example here, working set model is, if you say this within 10, let us take the time 10. Time to be 10 minutes or 10 milliseconds like that. In 10 milliseconds, how many pages are referred? Let us take the limit as 10. So if you take that 2, 6, 1, see here, 1 is referred, 2 is referred, and then 5, 6, and 7. If you take the first 10 pages, only the 5 pages are referred again and again. 5 is referred again, 7 is again and again referred. So this can be called as the working set model. So you can take the first 10 reference, how many things. So here I'm giving it as an example, only with the 10 reference, but normally it will be 5,000 or 1,000 page reference like that. 5,000 reference, 10,000 reference or 1,000 reference like that, you can carry over. For explanation purpose, it is given as very small amount. So if you take this 10 references, okay, 10 reference, I'm not talking about 10 pages, 10 reference, then again and again for the fourth page reference is made again here. So in this first 10 references, only 2 pages are referred. So this is said to be the locality of reference at this time. Here locality of reference at this time is this. So the locality of reference varies. So if you allocate, say for example, in this period only 2 frames for this at this time, then it will execute without any page fault. That is the conclusion we can come here. For this you can allocate 5 frames, okay, so in order for this to avoid the page fault. Like this the working set model has to be built. So and the problem with this is the working set model migrates, because as I said, at one time it will be the reference is somewhere, then after some time it reference will be here. See, after this it's over, but here if you see that reference, if you take from here, here already one is referred, here again the reference comes. So at any point of time the working set model keeps migrating because of we are taking the active window. So how you can calculate a working set model? A working set, you can take this as the number of working page reference. If you take this delta symbol, you can take the fixed number of page reference, and that we consider as a working set window. So for example, 10,000 instruction. As I have said here, we have given only a reference. It is only a small reference. But let us consider if you take 10,000 instruction and we call working set of process PA. Total number of pages referenced in the most recent 1,000 instruction. That's what. So here, if you take the total demand, you can calculate the total demand for frames to be the frames, number of frames needed at that particular time. Then M equal to total number of available frames. Then if the sum total demanded frames is more than the available frames, then the thrashing takes place. So when your thrashing takes place, even if you allocate, okay, if the total needed frames is more than the total number of available frames, then the thrashing occurs. So what is the policy we have to take? If this case occurs, then we have to suspend one of the process. Then the suspended process pages are swapped out and its frames are allocated to other process. Later, the suspended process can be restarted. So what is the disadvantage of this, or what is significant, whatever it is? So if this delta, if you take it to be very small, as we have seen only 10, it will not encompass entire locality. The entire locality cannot be encompassed. Very small space only does. So that is the one problem. If delta is too large, then it will occupy many localities. Overlap will take place from one function to another function like that. Many pages will be considered as locality. That is also not good. So if the delta is infinity, then it will encompass the whole of the user process. So this is what we have seen. So difficulty is to keep track of working set window as it is a moving window. At each memory reference, a new reference appears. So after this, if you take another one, the new memory reference may take place. Say for example, if you take this here only 3, 4, but the next reference will be 1, which is a new reference. By the time this window moves here, if you take 10 windows, so from 4 to 4, 3, 1, now the window becomes 1, 3, 4, because this also will be included. That is what this line states. At each memory, new reference appears at the end, and the oldest reference, it may drops off at the other end. So how to keep track of this working set? What is the validation you can do? So approximate working set with fixed interval. We can keep a fixed interval, timer interrupt, and a reference bit. So what happens? Assume there are, let us take this delta value to be 10,000 reference. Now you keep the timer interrupt. After 5,000 time units, there will be an interrupt. Okay, then at that time, how many? By the time 10,000 references might have been over. Now, we have to keep a reference bit for each frame. And we have to keep two more bits. So that if a particular page is how many times it is referred, that will be kept in the bits which are kept along with the page. So whenever a timer interrupt, copy and set the values of all the reference bits. Now, another... now a timer interrupt takes place, which is 5,000 after 5,000 time units. Now again 10,000 reference has to be done. Now what it will do? It will refer the previous page references. Since they are all page referred, a page fault takes place, and already they must be in the main memory. And those informations, the page reference informations also will be copied along with them. So now that those copied reference bits will be checked for this page reference, that is new working set model. If it is already existing there, then it can be saved. So if one of the bits is in memory, then the page is in working set. Now for this, it will be made as reference bit for the current working set model will be made 1. Why is this not completely accurate? So that is because of this 5,000 time units. How to improve the performance of this working set model by reducing the 5,000 time units by to at least 1,000 time units. And the number of bits, here we use only 2 bits. Instead, if we use 10 bits, how many times that particular page, so for example, 7th page may be referred again and again. In that, the count becomes more. Just 2 bits may not be enough to keep the count of that. So in that case, you can go for 10 bits, which keeps count of how many times a particular page is there. When a particular page is referred again and again, there are more possibility that it will be in the main memory. So there is no need for the page fault. So for that particular page, in the working set model, that can be included. And indicating that it is in the main memory itself. So next one is page fault frequency scheme. Another way of handling thrashing is the page fault frequency. And this is mainly about preventing the thrashing. After occurring thrashing, how to handle that? It's not right. How to avoid that? How to prevent the thrashing? So what we have to do is acceptable page fault. That is, we define the upper bound and lower bound. So for example, for a process only, 5 page fault may occur. That can be taken as the upper bound. Lower bound, 1, 0. Like that it can be taken. So you have to define the upper and lower bound on the desired page fault rate. If the actual page fault exceeds the upper limit, suppose the page for a particular process, we have defined upper bound to be 5. But another, all the 5, it have 5 pages. But now it is again asking for the another page to be done. Now it exceeded its upper limit. So allocate one frame. Allocate another frame for that in order to manage it. If the actual page fault rate below lower limit, that means there is no page fault at all. So in that case, which means that that process is sitting idle. It has finished its execution. So now we can remove one by one frame. So what happens? We fix the upper and lower limit of the lower bound for the page fault rate. So if the actual rate is too low, then the process will lose the frame because we are going to remove a frame because it doesn't need, already it is over. If the actual rate is too high, that is it is still executing, it has to need another frame in order to swap in another page of that particular process. So now the process gains a frame. So this is what we have seen, how the thrashing is handled. So